Faces ex machina, the musical faces from the eye of about 9000 to S1L Simon and E Simon and Ava.
Oh, the film.
This is a preemptive
encouragement.
Preemptive approbation.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm very happy to be here today. As Massimo said, the title of my presentation is quite long. Here you can see already a synthetic face, which is my face. It's quite uncanny, I think. In fact, the theme of my paper today is basically the concept of the uncanny valley, already in some way evoked by Natalie, by Gabriele and others, other speakers, which is a concept usually related to psychology, but that I think could be implemented also from a semiotic perspective. Here you can see a brief summary which put in order some of the things I would like to talk about. Also some conclusion related to the new discipline, quite new discipline of social robotics, robotethics and so on. But the base, as I said, is the uncanny valley, which is deeply connected, I think, with the Freudian, but not only Freudian, concept of the Unheimliche. Sorry for my bad German and not all German pronunciation. A concept which is coined canonically by German psychologist Ernst Jentsch, who, and here I'm quoting Fetikaba, points out that the uncanny arises from the case of uncertainty when a person has a difficulty making a decision. According to Jentsch, physical uncertainties can be the causes of the uncanny. The answers to the questions such as, are the objects which we visually perceive alive really alive, or are the objects which we perceive as non-living really non-living, create adapting mind. The way to overcome this feeling of uncanny might be to identify the thing which creates the doubt. And Jentsch refers to a literary case, as you probably know, Der Sandmann by Hoffman, which is a tale about this guy who fell in love with a beautiful woman, which is an automata, I don't know how to say it in English.
Automata.
Automata, okay, right. Automata. And there is this thing of the face in the tale. They say that she has a doll face. There is a problem with her eyes and so on and so forth. And the uncanny arises because it's difficult to define if she is or she's not alive. Freud taught the concept so something more, that the concept is related to the theme of the double. This conceptualization was also made by Otto Rank, the importance of the doppelganger and so on. In the history of cinema, we have several cases of the theme of the double related to the face, from very early movies like The Student from Prague, Lo Studente di Praga, two movies really recent, like Us by Jordan Peele in 2019, which is a movie all based on this uncanniness, eeriness related to the double. But this concept seemed a bit abandoned, seeing several decades ago this article by Masahiro Mori, a Japanese scholar, Bukimi no Tanigensho, translated in English as The Uncanny Valley, an article which in a certain way talks again about the concept of the uncanny. An article quite controversial, a very iconic article studied by lots of people, and I'm going to give you some example later. which can be resumed with this graph. This is the graph related to the perception and the feelings experienced in front of an automata. And the graph basically said that the more the automata you approach is human-like, the more you experience positive feelings. But there is a certain point, this point, the point where the automata is both too human and not too human, where you precipitate into this valley zone, the uncanny valley. Masahiro Mori talks about generic anthropomorphic robots, so he talks about robotic arms for in factories and so on, but the theme is really related to faces. Masahiro Mori also talks about prosthetic hands. We heard the word prosthetics today. Corpses, zombies, and so on. In cinema, this issue arises especially in the era of animation, computer animation cinema. So cinema with CGI technology, computer generated imageries. One of very well known example was Toy Story, but Toy Story is different, and maybe if I have time I explain why. One of the first example related to the uncanny valley in animation cinema is Final Fantasy. This movie is taken from a very famous brand, video game brand. It's a Japanese movie, of course. And in the critics, Peter Travers in Rolling Stones wrote that the animation was very well made, but there was a problem with the face. There was coldness in the eyes, the theme of the eyes again, and the mechanical quality in the movement of the face. And in some way, this thing created quite a disturbing result in the viewer. This phenomenon has been also faced by Angela Tinwell in this quite good book, The Uncanny Valley in Games and Animations, where she underlines how one of the most important problems for video game designer is in designing faces, because it's very difficult to design a human face avoiding the uncanny valley effect. But also Angela Tinwell, quite surreptitiously, says that while by a psychological point of view this phenomenon is usually explained as an evolutionary phenomenon, maybe it could be explained in a more fruitful way as a developmental phenomenon related to the so-called perceptual narrowing, so the ability to detect shapes and discerning shapes basically from the birth till the death. Tinwell says that any observed incongruence alerts people to oddness and the possibility of unpredictability of behavior, which is alarming, even distressing and scary, as it may present a potential threat to personal safety. Hence, the sensation of uncanniness may serve to act as a sign of unpredictability and danger. So the problem of the uncanny face is that it's a face which has something unpredictable. I return back to this concept later. Other examples in cinema, very made by very famous directors, for example, The Adventures of Tintin by Steven Spielberg, which is a movie, of course, based on the famous Belgian comic, was shot with capture motion technologies. So basically there were spatial cloaks mapped capable to take the movements of real actors and transfer them into computer technologies in order to be animated. The problem was that they could capture movements of the body but not the movements of the face, the muscles of the face and the gazes. In fact, the critics say that Tintin looked simultaneously too human and not human at all. They defined his face as weirdly feature, with glassy eyes and a vacant gaze, basically. And of course, the uncanny valley locution was quoted again in this article by John Bates. Another example was Polar Express by Robert Zemeckis, another famous director. Here, behind this character, there was, I think it, we can say, a quite talented actor like as Tom Hanks. But the problem was in the face, who was seen as a puppeteered corpse. So again, this theme of the death in the face related to the eyes, where there should be the sparkle of life, but it's very easy to create artificially this sparkle of life. Nowadays, 10 years later, technology has been improved, of course. So we could think that this problem has been overpassed, but it's not totally right. But I will just like to quote you recent, really recent technologies like this one, the Unreal Engine. Our game designer and ludosemantician here probably know it because it's a graphic engine developed by the Epic Games, who is capable to create really realistic artificial face. Here, for example, we have the example with the split screen with the real actor and Andy Serkis, and how his face is transferred to an imaginary character. But the fact was that the real actor wasn't a real actor because his face was ready-made by the software, by the engine itself, so it was quite an Easter egg, really strong by the Epic Games, which defined this face a high-fidelity digital replica. The viewers said that it was quite similar to the human resemblance, but the problem of Uncanny Valley was always there, for some reason really difficult to detect. As I said, this concept of Uncanny Valley has been considered as quite controversial, but at the same time was largely studied by many scholars, like these scholars who have very unpronounceable names, but I think Finnish names, maybe Mattia can say them better than me. Cazzili et Ali. Sorry for the Ali. Hi guys. Yes, this concept is related to several other features. For example, there is the theme of the movement. It's different if we watch if we look at a artificial still face or artificial moving face, but their thesis, which I think it could be quite interesting, is that the problem arises when our perceptual familiarity with the face types is put in a kind of confusion with what they call categorization ambiguity and perceptual mismatch. Cazzili, furthermore, and Cazzili et al., furthermore, underlines how this concept has also semantic problems. Firstly, there are problems in the original translation of Bukini no Tanigensho, which has been translated as the Uncanny Valley, but this translation is not so accurate because probably it should be Valley of Eeriness, and there are semantic problems in the translation, as we all know, because we all know semiotics, you better than me, but I know this thing. But the problem related to the concept is that of the categorization ambiguity and perceptual mismatch, but also on the nature of creepiness, which is very difficult to define by a semiotic perspective. I like the definition proposed by McKendu and Kuhnke, who in this article, to be honest, tend to stay into an evolutionary and really psychological-centered dimension, and I'm not, I do not agree with their conclusion, but I really agree with their premises that are that when we approach a face, usually we activate a sort of creepiness detector, which is related to an agency detection. So while approaching two stranger faces, immediately we define if they could be or not be harmful for us, dangerous, and so on and so on and so forth. This operation, it's not easy to define if it's only a kind of impactual operation or if there is an interpretative operation after the perceptual impact, but experiments, at least on my opinion, prove that there is the insertion of the interpretation in this process. Here we have examples of how the uncanny valley was proved by experiments. Here we have a graph related to an experiment by Matur and Redding, but I think the most interesting image is this one. Here we have 80 faces disposed from the more mechanical to the more human, but these faces have been disposed like this, taking the results of a survey which was given to a pool of people selected by Amazon Mechanical Turk Service. And these images were shown not in this order to the pool of people. The people were asked to vote to rate the human likeness or mechano likeness of the image, to say if the image suggested to them more positive or negative feelings, and also to say if they would like to invest $100, to give $100 to that face, to that singular face, in order to be invested in an investment. The result is that the pool answered in a very coherent way, so there wasn't particular incoherent answers. But it's interesting to notice that the question about the positive or negative feelings showed that while the very mechanical and the very human-like images evoked positive feelings, this zone evoked negative feelings, and this is the zone of this is the uncanny valley zone where the faces are at the same time human and not human because of some feature in these faces, features which are quite difficult to define because we were talking about this with Gabriele. It is not probably a problem of pertinence, but from a semiotic perspective, we tend to start from this idea that there are pertinent traits in faces. And we, for example, say that face number 10, if put in comparison with face number 12, has more pertinent traits because has eyebrows, has a mouth, and so on, but has been considered as less human than face 12 for some reason. The same could be said, for example, if with face 34, which seems a nice old man, but for some reason less human than face 35, 36, and so on. This is quite a problem of semiotic categorization of this face. Another thing interesting is related again to the theme of deep eye. Here I'm quoting a research by Valentin Schwind and Solvi Jäger, which utilizes the eye tracking technologies and shows us that if exposed to faces, to images of faces, we spend much more time in looking to the eyes, which is the first line. It's seven seconds by average, And for example, we spend less time in looking to cheeks and so on. Here we have the line which shows the time and the different short faces from the hyperreal cartoon to the ordinary human. By a more philosophical perspective, this is related to a lot of things already evoked by Natalie. All the theme of the oculocentrism, so the centrality of the eye in culture, related to tribal ancestral phobias like paleophobia, which is the phobia of dolls, azotrophobia, which is the phobia of the mirror, especially of looking at ourselves, the mirror. We can move certain hypotheses about these socio-semiotic processes. For example, someone this morning talked about the panopticon, Mattia and those. We already know we live in a panoptical society. We more or less accept this thing, but it's more difficult to accept it if there is an anthropomorphization of the eyes which look at us, which immediately assume a more strong instance of a gaze, of the gaze, which is related to the problem of being watched, phenomenological instances related to the gaze, all related, in my opinion, to also to problem like the problem of the interpolation in photographs, in cinema, and so on. And in fact, cinema already explored, starting from the theme of the eye, how the eyes could be strong and powerful. Here we have just two examples: the eye of Al 9000, of course, from the film by Kubrick, 2001, and Wall-E, this little cute character, little robot, who has not a real face, who has only two eyes, really expressive eyes. So we could also think, and this is my idea of converting the psychological idea of the uncanny valley to a semiotic idea, to the face and the synthetic face as something which has a precise syntagma, a syntagma which is problematic because the syntagma of the face is the eyes, the nose, and so on, but it's not easy to define if when we impact a face, we immediately perceive it by a componential logic, by a prototypic logic, and so on. But if we analyze how facial recognition pattern work, we can say that it is not a problem of pertinence, as I said. This semantic dimension that can be defined by a semiotic square, which put in as opposite artificial and human, and in the angle of non-human, probably there is the zone of the uncanny valley, which is basically a pragmatic outcome, a pragmatic outcome which involves a modification of the common interactional practices human and computer, but also human-human, which can be explained, this is my thesis, in a sort of problems related in the codifying the enunciational patterns of the synthetic faces. So basically in defining what is between the lung and the parole of the machine, and that also involves a kind of an activist problem in the proposition of ourselves and of our relation with the world. Another, Mori had a solution, which was just not to try to imitate human appearance, but to step the design one step before, but we see that we are trying to create really realistic artificial faces. Another hypothesis I had is that there is probably a difference between active and passive anthropomorphization. This is a very classic experiment by Heider and Zimmel in 1944. There is no music. Here we can see some geometric shapes doing something, but we immediately narrativize them and anthropomorphize them. So we do an operation of active anthropomorphization. So for example, we see Fia, we see the big triangle who in kind of bullying the little triangle and so on, or maybe a dance, I don't know, whatever you want. This active anthropomorphization gives us a feel of control based on what we call interpretative cooperation, which is also an ideologically oriented operation, while if we are exposed to an artificial face, we feel kind of a passive anthropomorphization. We have no a different, an immediate control to what we are perceiving. And this is probably also related to something ideological related to the double and our power and our control to reality. Cinema and synthetic faces, how many time I have? Okay, I'm concluding. As I said, in all the animation cinema, but of course significant peaks in the era of CGI, all the sci-fi movies, here just a few examples that came in my mind while doing the slides. The theme of also of digital rejuvenation and resurrection, and maybe I conclude with this one. And also, of course, in art films, there is this practice of creating artificially faces. This is a very famous shot by Persona, Ingmar Bergman, which has something strange if we see that it's not properly symmetric, because these are two different faces of the two different main characters of the movie meshed up together. And of course, after these considerations, for example, sci-fi movies invented lots of connected little subgenres related to faces. For example, the theme of retractable faces, which is deeply connected to the idea that behind faces there is something dangerous, harmful, or at least other. Here we have the Westworld, the new Westworld, the bicentennial man, and there are also issues related to the materiality of the skin of the face, the silicone faces and so on. Of course, artificial intelligence by Spielberg, there is this big sequence of the flesh pair with all these different obsolete machines with faces, broken faces and so on. This very disturbing scene of the nanny robot I don't want to spoil you, but the movie is from 2000, so is killed by, and his face burns in front of the little robot David, example like this. This TV series, Small Wonder, I remember it, I was a child, and it disturbed me a lot, because the little monster called Super Vicky was the real representation of the Uncanny Valley, because of the vacuum in his face, of this vacuous gaze. There is also a gag in Family Guy, but I have enough time to show you. I would like to finish not with the Uncanny Prometheus, but which was in the title of my paper, but next time, but with this idea of the resurrection, face resurrection. This is a very famous, let's say, you know, the case study, Star Wars Rogue One, 2016. Peter Cushing's, here I'm quoting Sargent. Peter Cushing's performance in 2016's Rogue One, A Star Wars Story, is remarkable because Cushing died in 1994. Industrial Light, a magic computer-generated imager, Wizards, digitally resurrected Cushing to once again portray the villainous Imperial Grand Moff Tarkin, a central antagonist of the original 1977 Star Wars. Which is, of course, the idea, the illusion, and not only the illusion, of the ghost in the body, the ghost in the face, the ghost face, which is a very famous villain in one of the most famous slasher sagas by Wes Craven. I have no time to talk about social robotics, robotics, and to Sophia. Was my conclusion. The last thing I want to say that Sophia has been the first non-human being to get the citizenship of a nation. She is a Saudi citizenship. She's politically quite interesting. Also, she is the first non-human to get an award from the United Nations. She is a mediatic phenomenon. She, Jimmy Fallon, but lots of talk shows all around the world as Sophia as one of the main guests. But she is nothing more than a chatterbot. So all this humanity is related to her face because the technology behind this machine is not a real artificial intelligence. She is nothing more than the chatbot we interface when we want to solve the problems with our telephone and we go into a provider website and we chat with a chatbot. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Bernsuracha. It's a very rich presentation about this very important concept of the Uncanny Valley. Any questions or comments?
Maybe a very short question.